Hello everyone, my name is Paola Carnazza and I work at a conservator within the restoration laboratories of the Galleria Nazionale d'Arte Moderna e Contemporanea here in Rome. The work I am going to present today is entitled Cleaning Contemporary Restoration Varnishes by Green Solvents, and it has been carried out in collaboration with the UCOCO APS Association. The case study we worked on is the oil painting on canvas by Antonio Mancini entitled Il Venditore di Cerini. It needed a restoration treatment due to the presence of a noticeable layer of a film-forming material which was characterized during the first stage of research. The main goals of the work were indeed the characterization of the paint layers and other materials to guide the conservation treatment and the selection of a suitable green cleaning system able to selectively remove the aged varnish. The peculiarity of the artwork is the use of the graticule method, an artistic technique invented and used by the artists since 1889. Antonio Mancini used to place a cotton gridiron from the posing figure and another one of the canvas, measuring the distance between the threads on the first and transferring them on the second frame, maintaining the same proportion. Once the painting is completed and the frame is removed from the canvas, the typical and particular Mancinian imprint is generated on it, impressed by the threads that arise from the thick layer of color, as you can see in the details on the bottom of the slide. The diagnostic process aimed at the acquisition of significant elements to guide the conservation treatment of the artwork through both non-invasive and macro-invasive techniques. Non-invasive analyses were performed in restoration laboratories of the National Gallery. Multispectral imaging was carried out using visible UV and IR spectrum bands. UV fluorescence was used by identify and characterize the presence of film-forming substances on the surface, while mid and near-infrared spectral bands allowed to verify the presence of IR active materials. In addition, the examination on the surface morphologies was carried out using a portable optical microscope, Dinolite, which allowed observing the surface at different magnification using three illumination modes: visible light, UV light, and Rankine light. Non-invasive techniques enable the selection of the sampling areas based on the goals of an investigation. The samples were studied by Fourier transfer inference spectroscopy, FTIR, in ATR mode and by scanning electron microscope coupled with an energy dispersion microanalytical system, SAM-ADS. Portable optical microscopy analysis examined the artwork surface, assessing the presence of many color gaps which allowed seeing a blue layer underneath, as you can see in the picture on the left. The surface appears to be covered by an orange-brown varnish that shows yellow fluorescence under UV light, as you can see in the central picture. Also, large brown stock alternate with thin layers of color that use the ground layer to generate light effects. Eventually, fibers embedded in the paint layer were detected, which, if not added voluntarily by the painter, could be attributed previous conservation treatments as attested by lining of artwork. Through multispectral imaging, a deep investigation of the artwork's artistic technique and state of conservation was possible. The fluorescence induced by UV radiation showed that the varnish is not homogeneously spread over the entire surface. Being thicker on the left part of the figure, it seen from the front. The fluorescence on the varnish hides the signature the artist, proving that it has been applied on the top of the signature and consequently cannot be traced back to the set execution stage. Infrared reflectography allowed us to see the shapes more clearly, since they are partially covered by varnish. They seem to be only slightly outlined or without a preparatory drawing, showing the lack of predefined graphic setting. Indeed, no second truth or modification during the work can be detected. The transparency of the varnish under IR radiation highlighted the widespread presence of the craquelure, while the low contrast between the paint film and the color gaps proved that the paint film consists of a thin layer. Finally, it was possible to see the previously retouched areas, which differ from the original layers under IR radiation. After the non-invasive analysis, three samples were taken from the painting. The sampling areas are given here on the picture of the artwork. FTIR spectroscopy was performed on samples 2 and 3 without pretreatment. Spectra were collected on sample 2 by placing both the front and the back of the sample on the diamond of the ITR. The front is the layer on the top, while the back is the lining canvas, as you can see in the picture on the top. The spectrum collected on the paint layer shows bands related to non-aged dry shellac varnish, which is a standard material present in the Yokogo laboratory. The spectrum collected on the back of sample 2 shows the characteristic bands of cellulose and paste glue, which is commonly used in lining interventions. Sample 3 was collected in the form of powder and confirms the previous interpretation, since the spectrum shows bands related to shellac varnish here too. When seen from the surface, sample 1 appears to be characterized by two layers. In the external paint layers, the spectra collected show the presence of elements such as iron, lead, calcium, and phosphorus. These elements cannot be correlated with each other, suggesting that the blue area on the surface consists of an iron-based pigment, probably Prussian blue. The cyan group is given by the union of a carbon atom and a nitrogen atom, which is not detectable by SAM. The presence of phosphorus is due to the use of bone black, while calcium and lead are related to white pigments. This layer is on top of an iron-based paint layer, which is a base for the upper paint. The ground layers show the presence of zinc and lead, which are related to the use of zinc white and lead white respectively. Further investigation of the pictorial layers was performed on other section of the sample, as you can see in the picture at the bottom of the slide. The fragment confirms the stratigraphy and relative composition. However, ADS analysis on the pictorial layer shows the presence of chromium as an additional chromophore element, indicating the presence of chromium oxide green. Eventually, the presence of zinc together with the lead confirms the use of lidocaine in the preparatory layer. As to sample 2, the backscattered electron image allowed to define the presence of 3 layers. The paint layers are characterized by the same elements of sample 1, differing only for the purity of the layer adhesion to the preparation layer, which is characterized by the presence of iron, indicating the use of Prussian blue. Also, the preparation layer is made of white lead. The SAM-ADS analysis of the ground layer shows that it is made up of 2 layers. One is adhesion to the canvas and consists of zinc and lead, while an upper one shows a high lead content. Analysis of another portion of sample 2, the one we can see at bottom, confirms the results already reported. The chromophore elements of the paint layer's surface are iron, chromium, and phosphorus, while the preparation layer near the surface consists of lead and calcium carbonate. FTIR spectroscopy's analysis in ATR mode made it possible to identify the finished varnish as partially oxidized shellac. Although unusual, shellac varnishes derive from the consolidated practice of the workshop involved in furniture restoration. The yellow coloration of the varnish did not allow its use as finished varnish for paintings due to the residues from the extraction process. However, in the early 19th century, several bleaching methods for shellac were introduced, and the product was promoted as varnish for easel paintings, becoming a fashionable treatment first in the mid-20th century. Dust cleaning tests were performed to define a suitable cleaning system to remove the oxidized varnish. The required features for the cleaning system are suitable degree of solubilization on the varnish. Also, the system should comply with the principle of green chemistry. It should allow selective removal of the varnish and respect the principle of the minimal intervention, which aims at obtaining the maximum performance while operating in the least invasive way possible. The system should also be easy to apply and allow for control removal of the aged material. The scientific literature identifies ethanol as a suitable solvent for an aged shellac. However, shellac coatings can deteriorate as a result of esterification between the acid groups. Thus, this degradation process leads to different solubility degree and chromatic alteration resulting in brownish tones. Also, coatings composed of high molecular weight polymers, such as shellac, can be very slowly solubilized due to the size of the molecule. During the cleaning test, the solvents defined in the table were tested. The choice of operating with these solvents was made after the identification of the suitable FD parameter. 2 Paolo Cremonesi test. The most well-performing solution turned out to be a mixture of petroleum ether and ethanol in relative amounts of 70% and 30% respectively. Then the proposed cleaning systems were chosen among the green chemical alternatives already present in the market, leaving aside other green solutions such as biotechnology. These different cleaning systems were applied to confined areas using a mask. The cleaning efficacy was evaluated using dinolite invisible and UV light on the surface, the cotton swabs and the gels used for treatment. The observation allowed the restorers to build a scoreboard for each cleaning system, according to the criteria used for the selection of the solvents. The restorer was asked to evaluate the following parameters: degree of solubilization removed, varnish and the swabs, minimum intervention, selective removal of the varnish, and controlled removal of the varnish. The table summarizes the restorer's evaluation of the cleaning efficiency of the tested cleaning systems. The scale for evaluation varies within the following range: insufficient, poor, sufficient, good, excellent. The product that the restorer was most satisfied with what was Polar Varnish Rescue Gel. The following satisfaction scale can be shown as Polar Varnish Rescue Gel, Green Varnish Rescue Gel, Green Varnish Rescue Nano Restore, Cleaning, Ethanol, Water. The Green Varnish Rescue uses both the gel form and the swab also solubilize the varnish, respecting the characteristic of minimum intervention. In the other case, the pictures collected show that the paint has not been solubilized, although the surface has increased its brightness. However, this result is due to the removal of surface dirt and not to be solubilization of the shellac. Thus, the observations obtained using the dinolite of the areas cleaned by different products confirms that the Polar Varnish Rescue Gel is the best performing cleaning system for its respect of all previously defined criteria. After the cleaning test, the best solvent, namely the Polar Varnish Rescue Gel, was tested on the same area of application of water, which was known effective to optimize the number of steps or the contact time of the gel. It can be seen that the degree of solubilization is lower compared to the previous contact time, namely 3 minutes. Here you can find the conclusion of the entire study on the artworks. As to diagnostic stage, analysis revealed the following stratigraphy of the paintings: a ground layer based on zinc white and lead carbonate, white lead, probably an industrial ground layer already present on the canvas. Then a ground layer based on the white lead, this one applied by the artist. On the top of it, a blue primer made of olea and Prussian blue, and a thin pale layer made of the following pigments identified by ADS: Prussian blue iron and chrome green chrome. The tones appear to have been darkened through the use of bone black identified by the presence of phosphorus and calcium, with the quantitative values sometimes referring to the stoichiometry of calcium phosphate. As to the cleaning test, the Polar Varnish Rescue Gel proved to be the best performing cleaning system, showing a good degree of solubilization while guaranteeing a selective and safe removal of the beige varnish. Here you can find the synthetic bibliography. Thank you for your attention.